One of the arguments that people come up with every single day when I'm telling them electric cars are the future is the grid can't cope. Can the grid cope? And today we're going to be exploring, can it? Can the UK national grid, or any grid in anywhere in the world, cope with the influx of every single driver having an electric car? The short answer is yes, obviously they can. And the national grid have already made it very clear that they can cope already now with a massive influx of electric vehicles. And that is the first sort of reply I have to that argument, is the National Grid have already said they can cope with a massive influx of electric vehicles today. Now, there is a long answer to why it can happen, and there's a few alternatives that make this possible. But first of all, I'd like to ask you to click the subscribe button down below for my channel. And if you're already a subscriber, and if you're not already, click the little notification bell. Every time I make a new video, which is every single week currently, you'll get a notification when that video is uploaded. Now, one of the reasons is we don't all get home at exactly the same time and plug in at exactly the same time. Now, to explain what I mean is, if we all leave work at 5 o'clock, let's just say we all work, have a 5-hour working day, so we're just finishing at 5, or if we all finish at 6, we don't all get home at exactly the same time and plug the car in at exactly the same time. Thing that the grid struggles with, two things. One is peak. The grid's national grid is built for peak, so sometimes power stations are basically not running, because the grid is built for when the highest peak we could possibly get is to stop power blackouts. They don't build the grid for the running of every single day. It's built for the highest amount of peak. The other thing that the grid struggles with, apart from peak demand, is they also struggle with frequency response. Now, to put that mildly, if everyone got home at exactly the same time and plugged their car in at exactly the same time and turned the kettles on at exactly the same time, that demands a really high response off the grid to quickly turn on those power plants as quick as possible. And power plants aren't really meant to respond that quick. There's very, very few which can. Most of them are water storage, battery storage, and stuff like that. But now you're going to say, Nick, you just said that we don't all plug in at the same time. Some of those cars are still going to be charging when the other people get home at 7 o'clock. Because obviously most 22 kilowatt or 30 or 40 kilowatt batteries will take 3, 4, 5 hours to charge. Yes they will, and some of those cars will still be charging, which is why the National Grid and energy companies will come up with more inventive tariffs. Now, for example, I'm with Octopus Energy. If you want to use the link down in the description below to join them, it's £50 credit. They have what they call an EV Go tariff, and they also have one called Agile Octopus. And the way these two clever tariffs work, we'll start with Agile because it's probably the most inventive. You get half an hour pricing, and your pricing changes every single half an hour. Now, they pre-publish what these rates will roughly be and what they're going to be, and you can basically choose to charge your electric car when the tariff is at the cheapest. Now, occasionally, there is oversupply on the grid, and prices go what we call negative. Negative means that Agile Octopus's tariff will pay you money to charge your car. So they can basically incentivize tariffs like this with smart meters, because smart meters take half an hour readings, and the national grid and pricing structure of the grid is half an hour pricing. So smart tariffs fit in perfectly for that, and that is why smart tariffs are being rolled out even more, to get better sort of customized tariff like this. Now, the other one is Octopus Go, which encourages you to charge at night between 12:30 and 4:30. You pay 5p per kilowatt hour. Now, there's also Eco 7 tariffs, which do similar to this, and Eco 5, etc. like that. Now, there's lots of companies that do economy tariffs for cheap charging at night, and there's also going to be some tariffs that will discourage you from charging at peak times, peak loads. And if you're being incentivized by monetary value, you're not going to want to charge your car at 6 o'clock unless you absolutely have to. And this is how the national grid and energy companies will work towards balancing this peak. Now, the important part about this to learn, which is amazing sort of thing that no one really realizes, when the grid drops at night and there's no use and there's low demand, if you start filling up what the national grid call the bathtub, basically rising that low peak and bringing it closer towards the medium or peak level, then prices will actually fall in general for every single customer, because the grid is built for the lowest point. If that energy is now being used during the middle of the night, the power tariffs will start to sort of flex and sort of bring down the overall peak price because you're not paying for these power plants to be turned off because they're actually being used. Hello, the rest of the people who are now saying, yes, but I want to plug in at home when I get home and I don't want to be told when I can charge and not charge. So what if everyone's like me? How will the grid cope? Well, the other thing is not a lot of people will be like that. A lot of people will want to incentivize to charge at night. And because there's going to be quite a few of these people, even though everyone won't do it, personally, I'm more open to charging at night because I don't really need the car during the day. But if I did need it during the day, yes, I'd like to boost some electricity. And what if everyone wants a boost of electricity at the same time? Now, they're not going to all want it, but let's say there's a high demand during peak, football's on, half-time's just happened, and everyone's turned the kettles on. How will the grid cope with an influx of electric cars and that extra peak? Well, amazingly, electric cars will probably be the solution of their own making, and that is vehicle to grid, vehicle to home, or V2G and V2H. Vehicle to grid and vehicle to home is basically using the battery of your electric car. If you're in a, say you've got a 60 kilowatt battery, your average commute per day is 25 miles each way, so you're doing 50 miles a day, and your battery is full. Now you've got capacity there that you can sell back to the grid. The way it's going to work is the national grid will pay you to dump electricity back into the grid during peak. So if you're like me, prefer to charge at night, I'm charging at 5p during the night, and I leave my car plugged in during peak, but not charging, just plugged with a full battery, I can choose to dump that electricity back to the grid. Now, if I dump that electricity back to the grid, the national grid will pay me, say, 10p per kilowatt for the power I put back into the grid. So I'm making 5 pence per kilowatt hour by just leaving my car plugged in, fully charged and not using it. Now, on top of vehicle to grid and vehicle to home, there's other ways that the grid can deal and cope with the extra demand of EVs. And one of them is already being enforced in new OLEV rules soon, and that'll be all chargers will have to be smart connected. Now, the advantage of this for the national grid is if there was a massive influx of peak demand that the grid were really struggling to deal with, and they know where all the chargers are in a particular area, and let's just say London is completely undersupplied and they haven't got enough electricity to charge all the cars there, everyone's turned the kettles on, they're really struggling, smart devices like smart chargers will allow them to turn off your electric car charger, maybe even for just a brief 25, 30 seconds, 1 minute, 2 minutes, just while the grid deals with everyone turning the kettles on, and then when it dips again, they can return your charger back on. And one of the chargers that can do this was the talk I went to, which was the Zappy charger. They've got one way of doing it, which is basically they're going to be able to turn off your charger depending on what peak load is and an off-peak load. So in theory, the Zappy charger could be set to charge your car when electricity is very cheap and then turn it off completely when peak demand is very high. And the way that will be paid for is they'll incentivize you to do both. Incentivize you to charge when it's cheap and incentivize you to allow them to turn it off when you need it. And that is going to open some massive avenues, and a lot of electric charge car point installers and stuff like that, charge point makers, will be in sort of coming up with their own ways of dealing with this. Some of them will go to vehicle to home, vehicle to grid solutions, and some of them will go other ways. Now, the other way that EVs will help is secondhand EV batteries. Obviously, as many people will know, EV batteries are in what they call the closed circuit loop. Their recycling, etc., is all closed loop, which means that the batteries do not go to landfill, they get reused in other purposes. One of these is the new 350 kilowatt charging stations all have batteries on board which charge during low supply off-peak demand, so the national grid's not forcing 350 kilowatt down your charger at one point. They're basically dumping those battery loads plus a bit of grid backup as well for the same dumping in. Now, there's also batteries that you can get at home, like the Tesla Powerwall, Moxa, and some other batteries that you can basically have at your home that charge up from either off-peak grid sources or from solar if you have solar energy. Thank you very much for watching this week's video. Don't forget to click subscribe, don't forget to check out my other videos, and if you've not already, please visit my Patreon page and consider supporting me for a couple of pounds a month. I'd like to do more inventive shoots in different locations.